And welcome to week 3 of English 90. I'm here on our home page to show you the way to our work for this week. So click on English 90. And I'm going to go ahead and go into student view so you can see what you have to do. And I know many of you just go to the to-do list, but remember, you need to start here and go to modules. Click on week 3 and start with welcome. Normally, when you click on this, you'll see the lecture I'm giving you right now, right here. So you always want to begin by watching the week's lecture. This is like our class time. So this is where I'm telling you what we're going to be working on this week. So this week, what you're going to be learning is you're going to learn how to understand how to identify fragments and run-ons in your writing. We'll talk about clauses and phrases and how to have better sentence structure. You're also going to continue to strengthen your active reading strategies. That's when you're reading citizen, so that you can learn how to better interact with the text as you read it. You're going to further learn to critically think about a text. So after reading citizen, we're going to answer some very in-depth questions about it as a group in our discussion. And then you're also going to be learning strategies to revise your writing. So the essay you turned in last week, we are going to have one-on-one conferences to talk about your writing as a way to improve it so you can turn it in again. So to go over what is due this week, the first thing you're going to do, as always, is you're going to watch this week's lecture. Then you're going to review the grammar lesson on phrases, clauses, fragments, and run-on sentences. And then to assess how you did on what you learned, you're going to take the grammar quiz. It's just 10 questions. Then you want to move on to your work for citizen. We're going to be reading pages 23 to 36 this week. After you read this actively, that means with a pen, okay? Then you're going to participate in the citizen discussion. Your main post is going to be due on this Saturday at 11:59 p.m. Excuse me. It's important you make that deadline so that your classmates can interact with you. You need to post your own post and then respond to at least 3 of your peers' posts by Tuesday at 11:59 p.m. There are many, many times for you to meet with me for a conference this week, so you need to sign up for one right away. As soon as you watch this lecture, the first thing you should do is sign up for a conference. And after we have our conference, you're going to revise your writing assignment and turn it in by next Tuesday at 11:59 p.m. Just a reminder, you guys, you can always email me questions. I'm pretty quick to respond, unless it's the weekend. And then you can also visit me in my office hours. They are from 10:30 till 12, and I have office hours today. So let's take a look about the conferences. These are the times that I'm available to meet with you this week. If absolutely none of these times work, still send me an email as soon as possible, okay? You need to have a conference by Monday so you have time to revise your essay. So send me an email. This is my email right here. Either send me an email with 2 different times, or you can send me an email with a time that's outside of this if you cannot make any of these times work. This just showing up for your conference is worth 20 points. That's all you have to do is show up with a copy of your writing ready to talk about it. Okay? Please do that right away. So what we're going to be talking about this week is grammar. The sentence structure. We're going to start talking about the different building blocks of the sentence. So every sentence is made up of words, right? Those are the single units that make up a sentence. There are phrases, which are word groups that don't have subjects and verbs. And then there's clauses that are word groups with subjects and verbs. Here's an example. During the summer, comma, we visited the Grand Canyon. Each word in the sentence is doing something important, right? But which words join together to tell us who did what? So we is the subject, visited is the verb, and the direct object is the Grand Canyon. So this group of words is a clause. It's a word group with a subject and a verb. The three words that appear at the beginning of the sentence, during the summer, is just a phrase. It's a word group without a subject and a verb. There's no subject, there's no verb, right? And it just clarifies when you visited the Grand Canyon. So you could have the sentence, we visited the Grand Canyon, without during the summer. During the summer just modifies and gives you more information about it, okay? If you want more information, and I highly recommend this, if you want more information about the difference between clauses and phrases, click on this link. It's a little video that'll tell you more about the difference between the two. So why are we talking about clauses and phrases? It's because we are going to be talking about fragments and run-on sentences. So if you learn about the structure of sentences, it makes it easier for you to control the structure of your own sentences when you are writing. And the biggest error that you guys make is writing sentences that don't have a subject or a verb or a main point, which are fragments, or writing sentences that don't have that keep going, that have multiple, basically that are two sentences squeezed together. Okay. So for example, wandering around the museum all afternoon, right? That is a fragment because there's no subject. Who was wandering around the museum? A run-on sentence is, the yearly forecast calls for heavy rain, the drought might not end. Basically, that's two sentences that have been squished together. And to fix it, you would say, the yearly forecast calls for heavy rain, period. The drought might not end. So if you want more information on fragments, you can visit the Al Perdue website. I highly recommend it. And if you want more information about run-ons, you can visit the Walden University's Writing Center page about them. I'd like you to read pages 62 and 63 to reinforce this information about fragments and run-ons. So read that information in The Least You Should Know About English, and then take the grammar quiz. Also, if you want extra credit this week, visit the Writing Success Center and set up an appointment with a tutor to go over fragments and run-ons. You'll get 5 extra points if you just go before the end of the week. Here's your grammar quiz. Just click on start the quiz and you can take your quiz. It's just 10 questions. Each one is worth 1 point. Take your time and really think about the answers. The next thing we're going to be doing is we're going to be having a discussion about citizen. So we will be reading section 2. For those of you who did not buy the print copy of the book, this section begins with 2. And we'll be beginning with the page that has Hennessy Youngman, a still shot from his video that says, "Be angry." I'm going to go ahead and read a little tiny bit of this section, just the first page, to get us into it. I'm gonna model active reading. So before I dive into it, I want to reacquaint myself with who the author is. Right, we know who Claudia Rankine is at this point. We know when this was written. We know this is from Citizen, an American Lyric. Right. And then while I'm reading, I'm going to be asking questions. I'm going to be looking up words I don't know. So let's begin. Hennessy Youngman, a.k.a. Jason Moosen. And so I'm going to immediately circle that and say, who is this guy? Why is he important? Okay. Whose art thoughts take the form of tutorials on YouTube, educates viewers on contemporary art issues. And I'm going to say, okay, that tells us some information about this guy. I can just Google him and find out more information as well. In one of his many videos, he addresses how to become a successful Black artist. Riley, that's a word that I'm not really familiar with, so I'm going to circle it and I'm going to look it up. W-R-Y. What does L-Y, what does that word mean? And I'm going to write in the definition. Riley suggests Black people's anger is marketable. That's an interesting idea. He advises Black artists to cultivate an angry inward exterior by watching, among other things, the Rodney King video while working. So I'm going to make sure that I know what the Rodney King video is. going to look that up. It has to do with the LA riots. And I'm going to pay attention to why he would want to watch that. Okay. I can look up exactly what he's saying in this video that she's referencing by clicking on the link right here. This is the actual link to that video she's talking about, and I highly suggest that you do that. Youngman's suggestions are meant to expose expectations for Blackness, as well as to underscore the difficulty inherent in any attempt by Black artists to metabolize real rage. That's an interesting way to talk about rage, to metabolize it, so to process it, right? The commodified anger his video advocates rests lightly on the surface for spectacle's sake. So it sounds like what he's saying in this video is like a, it's almost like a, he's making fun of the fact that this is, he's being hyperbolic. He's being extreme in the way that he's presenting this information. It can be engaged or played like the race card, and is tied solely to performance of Blackness and not to the emotional state of particular individuals and in particular situations. So she's saying that this video, and so this is what I'd be writing down, not I'm not just teaching it to you, I'm interacting with it, right? So she's saying with this video that he is kind of making almost a joke, but not a joke, about the fact that Black artists need to take advantage of white, you know, the white audience's need to other and to play into the rage that Black people have and all of these things. So watch the video and process that page together. And if you're interested in this topic, we're going to talk about question one as soon as I finish reading the second page. On the bridge between the sellable anger and, quote, the artist, resides at times in actual anger. Youngman in his video doesn't address this type of anger. The anger is built up through experience and quotidian struggles. What does quotidian mean? Make sure you look up that word, you guys. Against dehumanization. So making someone feel like they're not human. Every brown or Black person lives simply because of skin color. This other kind of anger in time can prevent rather than sponsor the production of anything except loneliness. She's saying that the anger, the real anger that people feel from living in a racist society is a type of isolation. It's not something that becomes a productive thing to make art out of. You begin to think, so we go back to the second person now. Remember, second person is when you're addressing directly, right? So in this, like you wrote your essays last week, okay? You begin to think, maybe erroneously. Oh, there's another word to look up, you guys. It has the word error in it, so maybe it has something to do with errors. That this other kind of anger is really a type of knowledge, the type that both clarifies and disappoints. It responds to insult and attempted erasure. To present, to react, to assert is accompanied by visceral disappointment. Visceral is something you feel deep in your body. A disappointment in the sense that no amount of visibility will alter the ways in which one is perceived. So no matter what you do as a Black or brown person, according to Claudia Rankine, you will not be seen in the way that you want to be seen. Recognition of this lack might break you apart. Or recognition might illuminate the erasure that attempted erasure triggers. Whether such discerning creates a healthier, if more isolated self, you can't know. In any case, Youngman doesn't speak to this kind of anger. He doesn't say that witnessing the expression of this more ordinary and daily anger might make the witness believe that a person is insane. So that idea that when people actually break from this anger, they might appear to be insane comes up. Now, if you're interested in the topics presented in these first two pages, but also in the rest of the text, you should answer question one in the discussion. To answer question one, you're going to want to watch that video of Hennessy Youngman, Art Thoughts, How to Be a Successful Black Artist. And I want you to discuss how Rankine uses this video on pages 23 to 24. What does she say about an artist's anger? What does she mean by witnessing the expression of this more ordinary and daily anger might make the witness believe that a person is insane? And then as you read on, I want you to think about how does Rankine relate Youngman's video to Serena Williams? So on the next page, and insane is what you think. One Sunday afternoon, drinking an Arnold Palmer. What is an Arnold Palmer? Look up what this drink is, okay? Watching the 2009 Women's U.S. Open semifinal. And when brought to full attention by the suddenly explosive behavior of Serena Williams. Now, if you don't know who Serena Williams is at this point, you should look her up. She's a tennis player, an amazingly talented tennis player. So you should look up who she is and look up the Women's U.S. Open. Is a major tennis match, so you make sure you know what that is. Serena in HD, before your eyes, becomes overcome by a rage you recognize and have been taught to hold at a distance for your own good. So in this scene, which will be talked about, let's see, in question... I'm not sure where. So if you look up the 2009 Women's U.S. Open semifinal, you'll see, and I do believe it's talked about in question number two a little in that article that you're going to be reading, but in the 2009 and the 2004 U.S. Open, Serena gets some really bad calls from the judges. They call... that her ball is has a line error when it doesn't, like five times. And so she gets so frustrated. And it's not that she's just frustrated about that actual occurrence, like just that game, right? It's because she has faced racism in the sport of tennis for so many years. If you look at how many people of color who are playing tennis over the years, there are not very many, and she it's a very white sport, and she has faced so many different so much racism in it. And so you can see that what Claudia Rankine is saying is that it's the buildup of that, of constantly holding it in, of not reacting, and that eventually it just came out. Okay. Serena's behavior on this particular Sunday afternoon suggests that all the injustice she has played through all the years of her illustrious career, make sure you look up that word illustrious, flashes before her, and she decides finally to respond to all of it with a string of invectives. What's an invective? Nothing, not even the repetition of negations. No, no, no. She employed in a similar situation years before as a younger player at the 2004 U.S. Open, prepares you for this. Oh my God, she's gone crazy, you say to no one. What does a victorious or defeated Black woman's body in a historically white space look like? Serena and her big sister Venus Williams brought to mind Zora Neale Hurston's I Feel Most Against a Sharp White Background. So this is referring to question number three, you guys. Zora Neale Hurston is an amazing writer, and she wrote this essay, How It Feels to Be Colored Me, many, many years ago. Please, if you're going to answer question three, I would like you to read this text, although I do encourage all of you to read it. This is the source of the quote that is also appears in this Glenn Ligon piece, which we're going to come up to. This appropriated line, stenciled on canvas by Glenn Ligon, who used plastic letter stencils, smudging oil sticks, and graphite to transform the words into abstractions, seemed to be ad copy for some aspect of life for all Black bodies. So that idea, I want you to think about what both these pieces mean about what it is like to live like Serena Williams in a white space in a black body, or a perceived white space. Hurston's statement has been played out on the big screen by Serena and Venus. They win sometimes, they lose sometimes. They've been injured, they've been happy, they've been sad, ignored, booed mightily. They've been cheered, and through it all, and evident to all were those people who were enraged. They are there at all. Graphite against a sharp white background. So the idea that the way the audience, the way people feel that that they other the two of them in the sport. Here we go. So for question four, this is the video clip of the 2009 women's semi-open final. And I want you to watch it if you're going to answer question four, and talk about the rage that Rankine is writing about on page 20. Okay. We'll get to Millay next. Okay. For years, you attribute Serena Williams to a kind of resilience. Make sure you know what resilience is. Appropriate only for those who exist in celluloid. Look up what celluloid means. Neither her father, nor her mother, nor her sister, nor Jehovah, her God, nor Nike camp could shield her ultimately from people who felt her black body didn't belong on their court, in their world. From the start, many made it clear Serena would have done better struggling to survive in the two-dimensionality of a Millay painting rather than on their tennis court. Better to put all that strength to work in their fantasy of her working the land rather than be caught up in the turbulence, look up that word if you don't know it, of our ancient dramas, like a ship fighting a storm in a Turner seascape. So for this one, I would like you to look at question five, if you're interested in this topic. Rankine references the artist Millay on page 26. Serena would have done better struggling to survive in the two-dimensionality of Millay painting. So follow this link and look at the different Millay paintings. They're all of these people working the land rather than on a tennis court. Look at Millay and explain why you think Rankine made this statement above. Or question six, Rankine references the artist Turner's seascape on page 26. You can look up Turner and find an example of a painting of a ship fighting a storm to share as your post. And then I want you to talk about what are the ancient dramas that Rankine references in this paragraph, okay? The most notorious of Serena's detractors takes the form of Marina Alves, the distinguished tennis chair umpire. In 2004, Alves was excused from officiating any more matches on the final day of the U.S. Open after she made five bad calls against Serena in her quarterfinal matchup against fellow American Jennifer Capriati. The serves and returns Alves called out were landing stunningly unreturned by Capriati inside the lines. No discerning eyesight needed. Commentators, spectators, television viewers, line judges, everyone could see the balls were good. Everyone apparently except Alves. No one could understand what was happening. Serena in her denim skirt, black sneaker boots, and dark mascara began wagging her finger and saying, "No, no, no," as if by negating the moment, she could propel us back into a legible world. Tennis superstar John McEnroe, given his own keen eye for injustice during his professional career, was shocked that Serena was able to hold it together after losing the match. Though no one was saying anything explicitly, make sure you look up that word if you don't know it, about Serena's black body, you are not the only viewer who thought it was getting in the way of Alves' sight line. One commentator said he hoped he wasn't being unkind when he stated, "Capriati wins it with the help of the umpires and the line judges." A year later, that match would be credited for demonstrating the need for the speedy installation of Hawkeye, the line calling technology that took the seeing away from the holder. Now the umpire's call can be challenged by a replay. However, back then, after the match, Serena said, "I'm very angry and bitter right now. I feel cheated. Shall I go on? I just feel robbed." And though you feel outraged for Serena after the 2004 U.S. Open, as the years go by, she seems to put Alvarez in a lengthening list of other curious calls and oversights against both her and her sister behind her as they happen. So, question 7. Who is Marina Alves? Watch this video of the match between Williams and Capriati in the 2004 U.S. Open. Do you think Williams' reaction is justifiable? So when Williams gets really upset and starts cursing the line judge, do you think it's justifiable? Why or why not? And how does what happens in this match affect Williams during the 2009 U.S. Open semifinal many years later? And then also question 8 is, who is John McEnroe? He's mentioned on page 27. I want you to look up who he is and why he's famous for his rage. So why was his rage acceptable while Williams' rage is not? Okay. Yes, and the body has a memory. The physical carriage hauls more than its weight. The body is the threshold across which each objectionable call passes into consciousness. All the unintimidated, unblinking, and unflappable resilience does not erase the moments lived through. Even as we are eternally stupid or everlastingly optimistic, so ready to be inside, among, a part of the games. And here Serena is, 5 years after Alves, back at the U.S. Open. So now she's talking about the 2009 U.S. Open. Again in a semifinal match, this time against Belgium's Kim Clijsters. Serena is not playing well and loses the first set. In response, she smashes her racket on the court. Now McIntyre isn't stunned by her ability to hold herself together and is moved to say, "That's as angry as I've ever seen her." The umpire gives her a warning. Another violation will mean a point penalty. She's in the second set at the critical moment of 5-6 in Clijsters' favor. Serving to stay in the match, at match point, the line judge employed by the U.S. Open to watch Serena's body, its every move, says Serena stepped on the line while serving. What? The Hawkeye cameras don't cover the feet, only the ball, apparently. What? Are you serious? She is serious. She has seen a foot fault, and one no one else is able to locate, despite the numerous replays. No foot fault. You definitely do not see a foot fault there, says McEnroe. That's over-officiating for certain, says another commentator. Even the ESPN tennis commentator, who seems predictable in her readiness to find fault with the Williams sisters, says her footfall call was way off. Yes, and even if there had been a footfall, despite the rule, they are rarely ever called at critical moments in a Grand Slam match because you don't make a call, tennis official Carol Cox says, that can decide a match unless it's flagrant. Make sure you look up that word flagrant, okay? As you look at the affable Kim Clijsters, you try to entertain the thought that this scenario could have played itself out the other way. And as Serena turns to the lineswoman and says, "I swear to God, I'm effing going to take this effing ball and shove it down your effing throat. You hear that? I swear to God." As offensive as her outburst is, it is difficult not to applaud her for reaching immediately to being thrown against a sharp white back, to reacting immediately to being thrown against a sharp white background. It is difficult not to applaud her for existing in the moment, for fighting crazily against the so-called wrongness of her body's positioning at the service line. She says in 2009, belatedly, the words that should have been said to the umpire in 2004, the words that might have snapped Alves back into focus, a focus that would have acknowledged what actually was happening on the court. Now Serena's reaction is read as insane. So we go back to that idea of insane. And her punishment for this moment of a manumission is threatened point penalty resulting in the loss of the match, an $82,500 fine, plus a 2-year probational period by the Grand Slam Committee. So I'm not going to continue reading. I'm going to stop here, you guys. I do want you to pay attention, though, as you continue to read, right? All of this information is for you to read slowly and think about. The next question, question 9, has to do with the sound suit. And that's the picture of the person with the flowers all over them, found on page 33. I want you to pay attention to that. I want you to research Sound Suit by Nick Cave. And read this article about Nick Cave from New York Times. And I want you to tell me why you think Rankine included Cave's sound suit in this section of Citizen, okay? For question 10, you'll need to go to page, page 32 and 33. Why is the description of Serena Williams' celebration dance after her win at the All England Club in the Olympics in 2012 described as a crip walking? Why is that offensive? And how does she fight racial stereotypes throughout her career? And then the last question is, who is Arthur Ashe? He's mentioned on page 35. Why does Rankine compare him to Williams? So, make sure you read the entire section. I only read, I read a lot of pages for you aloud just so that we could interact like we would in class, even though you're not talking back, which I'm very sad about. But you can send me notes back or you can post them in the discussion. So this week, after you actively read those pages in Citizen, you're going to choose one of these questions. You're going to make sure that nobody else has already answered the question when you choose your question, okay? You're going to watch or read the information that's included and write an answer of at least 250 words that answers the question. Your 250 word answer is due by Saturday at 11:59 p.m., okay? And then you need to respond to at least with 150 words to at least 3 of your peers' posts by Tuesday at 11:59 p.m. All right, guys, that's it for this week. Make sure that you review at the end. Make sure that you did all of these things that are listed here. And if you have questions while you're doing this, don't forget, I am only a phone call an email away, okay? Hope you have a good week, and I look forward to seeing you online.